One. Two.
I was to stand there.
Three.
Say the ten numbers.
Four. Five.
And then fall over, but fall flat over. That was exciting. And the kids liked that too, I mean.
Nine.
That's the one thing they remember.
Ten.
In 1969, James Earl Jones was the first celebrity guest to appear on Sesame Street. Since then, he has lent his voice to some of the most recognizable characters in popular culture.
He told me you killed him.
No. I am your father.
I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son.
Beyond the voice, of course, has been the actor. And at 83 years old, he's still going strong. Now back on Broadway in a revival of the classic 1936 screwball comedy, You Can't Take It With You.
You spend much of this play smiling from ear to ear.
You caught me.
I did. I know it's the character, but you look like you're just having a great time.
That happens to be true.
Yeah.
But also, it happens to be a choice that the director and I made. Well, you know, it's the first time I've ever been in a comedy.
The first time? I mean, why did it take you so long to get into a comedy?
Well, I don't know. I guess I thought if you took acting seriously, you had to take acting as serious, you know,
yeah.
And serious stuff.
According to our records, Mr. Vanderhoff, you have never paid an income tax.
That's right.
Why not?
I don't believe in it.
In You Can't Take It With You, Jones plays Grandpa, the patriarch of an unusually happy and wacky family in Depression-era New York, whose members live life as they please, not paying income taxes, not working, simply because they don't feel like it. One review said Jones infuses every word with a steady grace. But Jones told us, for as long as he can remember, he's been uncomfortable with words, a man with difficulty expressing himself.
How can you think of yourself as inarticulate? You don't? Well, you think of yourself that
mm-hmm.
way? Really?
Oh, at parties, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm good at listening. That I learned well.
Yeah.
But keeping up can be a chore, yeah.
It began early during what he's described as a difficult childhood. His father abandoned the family, and he was raised primarily by his grandparents, first in Mississippi and then on a farm in Michigan. And he developed a severe stutter.
People would come to the house, and there'd be introductions made, and I couldn't introduce myself.
It was that bad?
Yeah.
It's kind of remarkable.
I found it was also good sometimes because silence isn't bad, you know. It's good to listen, and I learned to listen.
Jones says it was in part that very thing that drove him toward acting. A high school teacher had helped him overcome his stutter by having him recite poetry at the front of the class. In the early 1950s, Jones had just gotten out of the Army and decided to give New York theater a try.
And I didn't know I was landing in the middle of a revolution that involved theater being changed to every man. I just came and walked into it like a dummy out of the Army. And this stuff was going on around me. Suddenly, I began to put it together. And it was quite wonderful.
It was a time when Broadway embraced stories about regular people, like Willie Loman, the protagonist in Arthur Miller's A Death of a Salesman, and Stanley Kowalski in A Streetcar Named Desire, famously performed by Marlon Brando. But in Jones's very first small role on Broadway in 1958 in Sunrise at Campobello, a play based on President Franklin Roosevelt's struggle with polio, an old problem came back to haunt him.
I was playing a houseboy, and I had a scene. I came in to Eleanor Roosevelt. I said, "Mrs. Roosevelt, supper is served." Well, I got as far as Mrs. We're often hung on the M word, the mama word,
yeah,
or whatever
yeah,
you
yeah.
want to call it,
yeah.
A stutter is.
Mm-hmm.
I think the audience knew what was happening. It was a play. They bought tickets. I'm up there acting, and I can't talk. My line was simple: Mrs. Roosevelt, supper is served, and I exited. And the last time this ever happened to me.
It may surprise you that Jones, with undoubtedly one of the most recognizable voices in the world,
this is CNN,
says he still struggles with his stutter to this day. But it hasn't held him back on stage, film, or television. Jones has won 3 Emmy Awards, an Honorary Academy Award, and 2 Tony Awards for his stage performances in The Great White Hope, about a black boxer, and for August Wilson's play Fences, about the African-American experience and race relations.
And don't you try and go through life worried if somebody likes you or not. You best make sure that they are doing right by you.
Jones had several other notable roles, including Othello on Broadway.
People will come, Ray.
And in the modern film classic, Field of Dreams. Jones told us that early on his roles were limited because of his race.
I'm gonna bust it wide open, then we all go out for champagne lunch.
But despite being one of the most prominent African-American actors of his generation, he has never defined his career in racial terms.
I never thought there was such a thing as black theater or African-American theater.
Race wasn't even a consideration in the current production of You Can't Take It With You. All the other actors playing members of his family are white. But the 1936 version of the play did have some racial references, one of which made Jones uncomfortable.
My questions were, for instance, these writers wrote in 2 black people. It's 2 people who are servants.
Yeah.
When the girl who plays my daughter, Penny, says, oh, they're so cute. They're little like Porgy and Bess.
Really?
Porgy and Bess, the opera first performed in 1935, portrayed African Americans in ways that some, then and now, felt were racist stereotypes.
I recommend that we don't say that line. why beg the question?
The line was ultimately taken out. Ironically, after all his success on stage and screen in more than 200 roles, Jones is probably still best known for being the voice of Darth Vader in the Star Wars trilogy. And the first movie, released in 1977, may have been his easiest gig ever.
Star Wars was almost like for you, it wasn't a big deal, right? I mean, you recorded it fairly quickly, I understand. And
oh, and 2.5 hours, yeah.
2.5 hours, yeah. And yet it became one of the most well-known voices
because
in the world.
The overall theme of that project meant something to everybody. Yeah.
Jones says the roles he's most proud of, though, are ones in which he played characters who, like himself, struggle with language. Men like Lenny in Of Mice and Men and Hoak in Driving Miss Daisy.
Sure I do. Don't worry none about it. I hold on no matter what way she run me. When I was nothing but a little boy down there on the farm boat making, I used to wrestle hogs to the ground and kill them time. Ain't no hog get away from me yet.
Very simple people. People who don't articulate much. People like me who don't have language, who are inarticulate. I like Hoak in Driving Miss Daisy. Hoak invents a language of his own. He doesn't know how to use English as you and I are doing right now, but he has a way of talking that is quite poetic.